far of dealing with an emotion. What do we do when we feel very emotional about something?
Remove it or suppress it.
So we have two ways of dealing with it. Removing it or suppressing it. Resisting it or giving way to it. Right? Can we get a third way of working with that emotion? Because both these ways, okay, can be reactive and very in that moment fixing. When you're suppressing also, you're fixing. When you're pushing also, you're fixing. Right? So, can there be a third way of dealing with an emotion? A third way of developing a relationship with an emotion. And the third way is watching sensations in your body. So, when anger comes up, okay, of course anger is against whoever, right? I have an opportunity now to one, neither resist nor flow with it. Two, come out of my head, because now I have practiced the mindfulness. I know how to move away from my thoughts a little bit, hopefully. And to come and watch what are the sensations in my body. And then what do I notice? So I take a pause. I take a pause before reacting. And in that pause, I watch what's happening in my body. And I notice that my heart is heavy or is palpitating, or I can't contain it, this burning sensation in my gut, right? And my teeth are clenching and I want to say something. I'm really getting upset. Right? And I can notice all of this as an observer. But it's difficult at that time. So what do I do? Also watch my anger with a lot of gentleness. I can bring an angle of compassion to my anger, not to that person. The person is later, but first to my anger. You know when Thiknathan is, you know, the video, one of the videos I sent to you, remember you saw it a couple of weeks ago. When Thiknathan was asked, how do you deal with anger? He said, deal with it like a mother deals with a child. Watch it with that much love. Now can you imagine an emotion like that? Right? Why do we want to get it out of our system or suppress it? Why do we not want to deal with our anger? Why?
It's unpleasant.
It's unpleasant. That's the only reason. It's unpleasant to what? It's unpleasant to? To hold. It's unpleasant to? Stable. So we want to do something to just get it out or distract away from. It's unpleasant to hold, right? And now if we are to bring such loving attention to it, as a mother brings to a child, and the same, you can bring it to your jealousy, you can bring it to your sadness, you can bring it to your grief, you can bring it to all the difficult emotions. There is one example to your loneliness. Watching it with unbelievable love, then you realize that while anger is also you, the ability to be compassionate and loving and kindness is also you. That is also within. The silken handkerchief, like I said in the story, is already there. We are already the silk handkerchiefs, aren't we? So, ability to bring that loving kindness to that anger. Ability to bring one part of us to another part of us and accept it. Can you imagine what would happen to the anger at that time? What do you think would happen when you are...
It would just fade away.
When you can love your anger. When you can love being feeling so high,
actually... It's
not
enough.
Yeah,
this week something like I had some argument with somebody and like I was beginning to feel angry and I actually thought, okay, how can I use mindfulness to so I just observed it and very quickly I became very compassionate towards myself and the other person and I just faded.
So it can fade,
yeah,
but it can also amplify in the beginning. Because in the beginning, you're bringing as gentle as possible. Today, we don't even have the ability to be really compassionate and loving to our own selves. If we could be, we'd not be at war with anybody. There would be no wars. But we can't. We are not able to be compassionate and validating towards ourselves, and that is why we are issues with So, first we practice bringing this loving kindness and this attention to ourselves. This kind of loving kindness to ourselves. Does it look like a possibility? Yeah, then does it look like a possibility?
I think you will see things more in perspective.
Today I have taken something I have to share. Instead of reacting to it, if you respond to it in a proper manner, in a positive manner, actually I have noticed in my life it makes me stronger and becomes my weapon
to
deal with that situation at a later date.
Absolutely. And that's what. So you bring this response, which you say it's not reaction, it's response. But what we are trying to do is we are bringing this response in the form of kindness to the emotion. So we are not resisting, we are not flowing, we are not shutting the emotion down. Are we shutting the emotion down? We are seeing it in its rawest form, we are willing to see it. So when emotion comes up, when you're doing body meditation, right, then this is the answer. To see it with a lot of gentle loving kindness. As a part of you, as a valid part of you. Tiknavan says we look at anger and negative emotions, destructive emotions as mud, and we want to throw the mud out. Mud. And we want to throw it out. But you need mud to grow lotuses. Lotuses don't grow without mud. It's a part of you. It's a valid part of you. So first you have to stop disvalidating your own anger. First, your own lotus. The problem is, anger is unpleasant, and the thought associated with it is what? Either that person is a problem, or I am a problem because I am feeling angry. There's a need to quickly put blame on something. Right? By putting blame, we are unwilling to contain that anger or see it. It is arising in us. It is not a product of outside functions. It has to be a product of us because it is arising in us. And therefore it's a valid part of us, and therefore we watch it compassionately with love. Does that apply now to what we were saying? So can we watch this thing? Can we watch the panic that's coming up with loving kindness? Is one. Two, can we create loving kindness to make that movement if we need?
Using that space for judgment or what?
Because for some time, what I would do is would see why, if I cannot move, is even panic coming up. What happens to me when I cannot move? What is it that I cannot contain? What is it that I am not able to understand here? So the panic actually is insight into what is difficult. Right? When I feel trapped, when I feel stuck, or when I feel like I have to move myself when it's too difficult for me, something like that, right? I get into panic. Which means that it's a push on my personality to not feel a certain way. Then I'm rejecting the part of me that feels weak. I'm rejecting that part of me that feels incapable. I'm rejecting that part of me that feels I can't manage. And that part of me is being held by some bigger part of the group. This is how. Right? So there's this conflict going on. And the result of this conflict is this panic. There's so much insight available to us when we sit with something. Right? So we sit with that panic. We notice it. We accept that part of us which is saying I'm weak. We nurture it. We show it loving kindness. And then see what happens. And then actually what might happen is sitting with it might become easy.
Yeah.
It might actually be easy because then it's no longer a struggle for the weak part to assert itself. It's more a compassion. The compassionate part in you is able to embrace that part and say, hey, it's okay. And that's the practice. So while it looks like a practice of sitting, it's not a practice of just gritting your teeth and bearing it. That's not the practice. It's when you stay stuck in a place, what can come up as insight? And then what can you do to embrace?